Acts chapter 16, and it is verses 13 to 15. And I'm reading this scripture for you, but I'm not going to be the one preaching the message on this scripture today. We get to hear from Pastor Jamie, who is our senior pastor here. So go ahead and give it up. Yeah, there you go. So Jamie, thank you so much for being here and for preaching today. But if y'all would, if you are able, would you stand now for the reading of scripture? It says, on the Sabbath, we went a little way outside the city to a riverbank where we thought that people would be meeting for prayer. And we sat down to speak with some of the women who had gathered there. One of them was Lydia from Thyatira, a merchant of expensive purple cloth who worshiped God. And as she listened to us, the Lord opened her heart and she accepted what Paul was saying. She and her household were all baptized. And then she asked us to be her guests. If you agree that I'm a true believer in the Lord, she said, come and stay in my home. And she urged us until we agreed. These words are true and can be trusted. You may have a seat. And as Pastor Jamie makes his way up here, I want to just pray and ask you to pray for a moment as well, that God might speak to you today through his word. So would you pray with us? God, come and speak. Your word is alive. You are alive. And you are able, God, to take these words and apply it to a timely situation in our hearts. And so I pray that you would speak to every heart and mind in the room that is even remotely open to hearing from you today. And would you just take a minute now in the quietness of your heart, just 30 seconds or so, in your own words, doesn't that be fancy or spiritual? And just ask God to speak to you today. And now would you just ask God to speak to somebody on your right or your left today? God, speak to me, speak to us. We ask this in your name. Amen.
Thank you. As Pastor Taylor was talking, one of the connections that I made too for the other Jamie that we were lifting up in prayer was that he grew up here at University of Carolina and he was a part of this Boy Scout troop. And so in the midst of everything that he's doing right now, he's using a lot of the skills that he learned as a Boy Scout in saving people's lives and being a conduit of God's grace and love. And that's just an interesting connection to make as well. Well, it is a pleasure to be with you here today. And I have the honor of talking about gospel hospitality. Every service that we have is focusing on the same topics. Pastor Taylor preached to all of our services on the first Sunday, on the opening Sunday, as we kicked this sermon series off. And one of the things that struck me, it strikes me sometimes, is how phrases that we know what they mean, and we even know where they come from, but we've never done them before. Okay, one of those is circling the wagons. Now, obviously, how many of you have ever circled your wagons? I've never done that, but it's a phrase out of the 1800s where the settlers were out west, and when there was danger or there was potential attack, they would circle their wagons as the only means that they had of protection on the prairie. Circling the wagons was a great plan when there was lots of danger. But when the danger was gone, there was no reason to keep the wagon circle, right? Why? Because it was impossible to move forward to the destination if you just stayed circle up. Circling the wagons is intentionally not hospitable. Some churches, however, develop a circle the wagon mentality. So if you're an insider, you might feel really safe and secure and cared for, but the problem is there's no space for outsiders to enter into the circle. And being a church that is always circling the wagons is tragic. Now, sometimes it's important to circle the wagons, all right? When it's dangerous, when it's struggling. But ultimately, it also keeps others out. I have a friend who's a pastor, served in a different kind of perspective. And his job was to go around to lots of different churches and see what was going on there and give presentations. He visited over 500 churches in the Florida area. And he knew really quickly whether or not a church was living out the value of gospel hospitality or whether or not they were a church for insiders. And he saw all kinds of fascinating things occur. For instance, many times this happened to him. He'd be sitting somewhere in the sanctuary, and somebody would walk up to him and say, "Excuse me, sir, but you're sitting in my seat, and I'm going to need you to move now." Okay, that is not gospel hospitality. Now, the thing is, and I always encourage people, if you think that, don't let that travel from your mind to your mouth to a first-time guest, okay? That's not a good idea. One time, somebody came over. A lot of times this would happen. People would point at him, look over at him, point at him. They'd whisper to the person next to them, and then they'd come over and say, "Excuse me, but who are you and why are you here?" That is not a picture of gospel hospitality. Or one time, he showed up, as his habit was, 20 minutes early for the worship experience, and the doors were all locked and nobody was there. 5 minutes before the service, somebody showed up, and they still didn't have the key. They had to wait for the person with the key to show up. Newsflash, a locked door on Sunday morning is not a picture of gospel hospitality. Last night, we had a night of worship here where we shared testimonies, and it was great. Megan gave an awesome testimony. And one of the things, though, that I realized, I was standing out by my car, and I looked up, and I saw somebody heading for this back door, and I intuitively knew that door had not yet been unlocked. And so I sprinted from my car to the door. Now, this was a staff member who had their own key, but I said, "No, I'm not letting them ruin my sermon illustration for tomorrow morning. That door is going to be unlocked before Patrick gets to it. We're not doing that." Another time, he had a group of people who came over to him. They thought that he had more power and sway than he did, but they asked him. They said, "How can we get rid of our pastor?" The pastor was standing right next to him when he said that. That is not a picture of gospel hospitality. He saw all kinds of crazy things. One time, he actually almost saw an argument that almost got to the place where they were ready to duke it out, share blows with one another. That is not gospel hospitality. And the reality is, one guy said to him, "We don't want our church to grow. We're comfortable just the way it is. If you want to change anything, wait until I die." That's what you call a circle the wagon mentality, and that's circling the wagons when it's not necessary. Now, here's the thing. People make up their minds how they feel about a church 15 minutes after they arrive on the campus. It's not about, in other words, they make up their mind long before the pastor ever gets up to preach anything at all. They've intuitively sensed whether or not this community is welcoming and actually has space for them and cares and can care about them. And that's an important. And every church, every single one, believes that they are welcoming. But some churches are only welcoming to insiders, and that's not living out the value of gospel hospitality. I'll never forget when I was 12 years old, I had decided I was going to go visit a new youth group and just take this big risk, big step, and I was nervous about it, but I had my dad drive me to the church to drop me off, and when we got there, I'm perspiring, I'm nervous, and I was thinking about asking my dad to turn around and just go home, and maybe we'll try this another time. But I realized, well, if I do that, my dad's probably going to be mad at me. So the only reason I made the decision to walk in was because I didn't want to have to drive home and have that conversation. And so I got in. I remember I was welcomed by this adult with a big smile, who was very friendly, and he immediately walked me over to somebody else who was 12 years old. His name was Roger. And Roger kind of took me under his wing, wandered around with me, helped me introduce me to people. And I didn't know anyone else. I actually knew him from school, but I didn't know him well. But he helped me, figure out how to manage the dinner line and everything else. And and he hung with me the whole time. Within 2 weeks, Roger was my best friend. Do you think I kept coming back to that church youth group? Yeah, and that church youth group helped me experience life change, and it started with gospel hospitality. And I am so incredibly grateful and impressed with the gospel hospitality that I get to be kind of a firsthand noticer of here at University Carillon. One of the teams that's my heroes is the middle school welcome team. They got Leah, Maya, and Kaylee, and they do, I wish that everybody in the church could see the over-the-top welcome that 6th, 7th, and 8th graders get when they arrive. And sometimes they kind of get out of the car sheepishly, and I remember when I was 12 and I was that sheepish kid, and it's like, and sometimes they feel a little bit embarrassed about the over-the-topness, but I know they like it. I know they really like it, and they're enjoying this moment, and it's a great thing. Another group that I wish everybody could see is Friday Moms. Friday Moms, over the top. Talk about gospel hospitality and rolling out the red carpet. They do this incredible job of setting the table and doing a great job. They go over the top. One time the men, a lot of the men in these women's lives, they showed their incredible over the top hospitality by they had like a piece of cake from Publix and a plastic knife in it, and that was their picture of hospitality, because they're just guys, you know? But these women, they go over the top, and they're incredible. Or, like, one of the things, at every one of our services, we have a team of folks who is about welcoming and greeting and doing well. For instance, at our traditional service, the guy named Ed Kersey, he's here every week, and he's an organizer. He's got everything organized really well. And got a good team to greet and ush, and then he also before noon he's always got an email out to next week's team about what needs to happen. One time he let that lapse until the next day, and I said, Ed, what's the matter? What's the matter? What took you so long to get that email out? And every service has that. And this service, I mean, you guys really are hospitable. I mean, you do gospel hospitality incredibly well. If I were a first-time visitor here, I know that I would feel really welcome about coming here, and that's great. So another expression that's really old that we all know the meaning of is roll out the red carpet, and this hasn't worked at any service. So how many of you have ever literally rolled out a red carpet? Anybody? Anybody? No? We had somebody at a couple other services who've literally rolled out a red carpet, but, oh, that was the best ever. Okay. Thank you. Now, where this comes from is from a train over 100 years ago. Well, actually, in the ancient world, only people who were royalty were allowed to stand on red carpets. I don't know why, but that's the way it was. But in modern times, over 100 years ago, there was this train that went every night from New York to Chicago, and the porters would literally roll out the red carpet at the entrance, so these people who are paying an exorbitant amount of money will know how they're supposed to enter onto the train, where they go with their exclusive opportunities. There was a red carpet at the Grammys this last week. There's going to be a red carpet at the Oscars next month. There was red carpet at Super Bowl preparation all week long. They were doing stuff on red carpets. It's a symbol of hospitality for us. And it's an important one. It's about gospel hospitality for us. Let's think about it. These are rolled out, the red carpets, that are just for chasing awards or because you spent a lot of money. We roll out the red carpet for a completely different purpose. We roll out the red carpet so that people who matter to God know that they matter to us. And that's hugely important. Last week, Pastor Craig talked about the importance of mentoring, about relationship that was between Barnabas and Paul, as Barnabas took Paul under his wing and helped him be received by the new community that he had persecuted. And that's all about gospel hospitality and how important mentoring still is for the church 2,000 years later. What's interesting, too, he, in his sermon last week, he talked about an experience his grandfather had in 1950 at Asbury College, where there was a revival, and how that was his call into the ministry. There was another one of those in 1970. And guess what? Right now, there's another one happening. They've been worshiping constantly for 4 or 5 days at Asbury University. And the chapel is filled. It's standing room only. And Dr. O'Connor, it is not being led by the professors, is it? No. This is student-led. It started in the university and spread to the seminary. So the college students were originally leading the seminary students. And then the professors come, and they're just experiencing it. But classes have been canceled, and they're simply worshiping God and living into this great spirit. And it's about mentoring. It's also reverse mentoring, right? Younger people leading older folks. I experience that all the time here. One of the reasons why 3 years ago I was excited about getting to be the senior pastor at University of Caroline was because of the mentoring culture that I saw happening here already. The fact is, when I was at my previous church, I tried to hire 3 of your staff members away unsuccessfully. And, you know, Chris Holguin, he always teases me, said, how come you didn't come try and get me? And it was like, well, it's because I hadn't met you yet. I probably would have come after you, Chris, if I'd have known. So, but I'm glad that I didn't have the opportunity to lure you away, because you're in the right spot right now. Yeah, God, if I would have asked you, I know you would have prayed, and God would have told you not to come, so you're in the right place. But it's like, you know, so Pastor Taylor, who leads this service, I tried to hire her away, and she stayed here. I'm glad she stayed here, because look where I am. Yeah. And 2 weeks ago, we talked about the key verse in the book of Acts, which is Acts 1:8, where Jesus says, you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem, in Judea, in Samaria, and to the ends of the world. And in Judea, that is right wherever we are in that moment. In Jerusalem, that's right where we are. Judea is where we're familiar, where we're comfortable, family, friends, acquaintances, the people that we know in our lives, our sphere of influence. And then guess what? Samaria. That's the people that we have trouble with, that we struggle with. That's why people like Jamie are in places like Turkey, ministering in a way that many can't. Or there's also, just in case we're not clear that it means everywhere, there's the ends of the earth. That means there is nowhere that we are not called to be witnesses of God's grace and love and the power of the Holy Spirit. That is incredibly important. And the reason why that's the key verse is because we see that's what unfolds throughout the rest of the book of Acts. Now, one of the things that's always interested me, it used to bother me, I love it now, but it used to bother me, the ending of the book of Acts is so anticlimactic, so odd, really. I mean, there's all this growth and excitement throughout the book of Acts. There's signs and wonders and miracles. There's all kinds of people that are large numbers of people coming to Jesus Christ and know the Lord. And then it kind of ends like this in Acts 28:30-31. For the next 2 years, Paul lived in Rome at his own expense. Yay, what a miracle. He welcomed all who visited him. Yes, that's gospel hospitality. Boldly proclaiming the kingdom of God and teaching about the Lord Jesus Christ. And no one tried to stop him. Luke, that's it? Really? That's how you're going to end this book that was filled with so much of that, all that incredible stuff? And I think that Luke kind of leaves us hanging there in a way, without wrapping things up very well. So it used to make me scratch my head and wonder about that. But I think that obviously Luke ended the book of Acts exactly the way he intended it to, exactly the way the Holy Spirit led him to. So why did he end that way? Because when it comes to being the church of Jesus Christ, there's always a next chapter for us to write in the power of the Holy Spirit. It's as if Luke was saying, church, you in every generation and wherever you are, you are the next chapter in the book of Acts. You are Acts 29. And he's saying, keep going. Stay faithful. remember that there's always a new chapter yet to be written. And we are that next chapter. He's saying, you go and make disciples. You be my witnesses to the ends of the earth. But there's an interesting that happens in the chapter 15, just before where we're spending time in Acts chapter 16, where the church needed to circle the wagons around an essential issue, a non-negotiable question that needed to be addressed. And it was a dangerous conflict that needed clarification for the future. It had to be resolved before they went forward. So they took a break, they circled the wagons. And the question was, how are we saved? I'm not sure there could be a more important question than how are we saved? But they had to get it resolved. One group said, well, the fact is you have to become a Jew before you can follow Jesus. You have to be circumcised. Another group said, no. Gentiles simply step over the line of faith, say yes to Jesus Christ, and they're a part of the church. And they had to figure this out. So they heard from all sides on the issue. And they got to a place where James, who is the half-brother of Jesus and the leader of the church in Jerusalem, has this great phrase. It seemed good to the Holy Spirit and to us. And what seemed good was that we are saved by grace through faith in Jesus Christ alone. It's not Jesus and anything else. It is Jesus alone. Now, even though they dealt with this conflict incredibly well, I mean, they put on a clinic for a church in dealing with conflict. Acts 15 is the only chapter in the book of Acts where we don't see something really important happening. There are no new people who are following Jesus that become Christ followers. Why? Well, because the church has to circle the wagons and discover and figure out this big argument that they're in. And even though it went really well, circling the wagons meant that they couldn't roll out any red carpet. But right after this, we see the church once again get into the business of rolling out the red carpet through gospel hospitality. They didn't stay circled wagons. Acts 16, beginning at verse 6, says, we meet this woman, Lydia. It says, next, Paul and Silas were traveling through the area of Phrygia and Galatia because the Holy Spirit had prevented them from preaching the word in the province of Asia at that time. Now, usually what we see in the book of Acts is the Holy Spirit knocking down obstacles, destroying barriers to the good news, and making sure that the gospel gets a hearing. But here, we see something interesting. The Holy Spirit prevents them from going somewhere. Now, that's interesting. That means sometimes the Holy Spirit is the one who is responsible for the closed doors that we're experiencing. And always, if we fear an open door, well, guess what? The Holy Spirit wants us to walk through that. Verse 7, then coming to the border of Mysia, they headed north to the province of Bithynia. But again, the Spirit of Jesus did not allow them to go there. So instead, they went on through Mysia to the seaport of Troas. So what are they doing here? They're listening to the Holy Spirit. They've been prevented from moving forward. Now, as forceful a personality as Paul was, he made a decision here. He said, I'm not forcing my way into anything. I'm sensing the Holy Spirit leading me not to go in that direction, and so I won't do it. I'm going to listen and obey. I need to be guided by this Holy Spirit. Now, this kind of connection to the Holy Spirit sounds really weird to people who are outside the church. You mean God speaks to you and you sense his direction? Yep. That's exactly it. We've got to own it. We've also got to own that it can seem a little bit strange, but we believe that the Holy Spirit guides us, and we trust that guidance. Verse 9, that night, Paul had a visitor. A man from Macedonia in northern Greece was standing there pleading with him, come over to Macedonia and help us. Have you ever had a vision? I mean, one like Paul sees in this dreamlike state, he sees someone calling out to him, inviting him to come to Macedonia and help us. That's really compelling and motivating. It's good that we ask God for visions and that we trust him for them and that they can guide and lead us into the future in ways that are life-giving and beautiful. Now, I haven't had a lot of visions in my life, but one time I had this vision when I had just been assigned to serve a new church, and And I saw this large building filled with people worshiping. And it was confusing to me because I'd already visited the church and that building was not there. And there certainly weren't that many people there that were in that building. And so I was confused by that vision. But I also knew that I sensed from God I was supposed to stay at that church until that vision was fulfilled. That really seemed impossible to me. Ephesians 3:20 says that God can do more than we can ask or imagine. And so I said, hey, God, I can't see this vision being fulfilled. So you promised to do more than we can ask or imagine. So I guess that's what you're going to do here. And I knew that vision was fulfilled one Easter Sunday when I saw 700 people worshiping together in the building that we had built since I'd gotten there. And it was like, oh, I hadn't thought much about that vision, just stayed nose down and head to the grindstone. And it was like, no, okay, that's the vision that has been fulfilled. I think it's important that we learn with Paul how to lean in to the visions God gives. Verse 10. So we decided to leave Macedonia at once, having concluded that God called us to preach the good news there. Now, notice that there's an important shift here. Up until in the first 15 plus chapters, Luke has said they. Now he says we in this verse. What's he communicating to us? He's saying, you know what? I'm now a firsthand witness to everything that's going on. So I was present in the midst of all this that comes next. It's an important shift. And when the Holy Spirit opens a door, they walk through. When the Holy Spirit closed a door, they didn't go through it. Verse 11, we boarded the boat at Troas and sailed straight across to the island of Samothrace. And the next day, we landed at Neapolis. Man, there's a lot of confusing words to pronounce in here, isn't there? That's tough. From there, we reached Philippi, a major city of that district of Macedonia and a Roman colony, and we stayed there several days. On the Sabbath, we went a little way outside the city to the riverbank, where we thought people would be meeting for prayer, and we sat down to speak with some of the women who had gathered there. Guys, where were the men? What were they doing? Why weren't they present? See, what we know from this is that there couldn't have possibly been a synagogue in that community because it was required that 10 men be gathered together for worship to create a synagogue. So they didn't have a building, they didn't have a space to gather together and worship. And there were no men present there that day. And that's why they're gathered at the riverbank, because they don't have anywhere else to be at this point. And it didn't matter to Paul and to Silas that there were only women present. It didn't matter to Paul and Silas that there was such a small number of people gathered together. Now, at this point, Paul could have thought to himself, this is not the vision that God gave to me. In my vision, a man called out to me, so it's time for us to move on. But that's not what he does. Paul didn't let anything get in the way of offering gospel hospitality to this group of women. And 2,000 years ago, that was incredibly radical. Now, Paul is the one who later says in Galatians 3:28, there is no longer Jew or Gentile, slave or free, male and female, for you are all one in Christ Jesus. Verse 14, one of them was Lydia from Thyatira, a merchant of expensive purple cloth who worshiped God. Now, what does that mean? Well, 2,000 years later, a purple shirt's just a purple shirt. You got the memo. Good job. Good job. Andy's with me on the purple today. But what this meant was that she was wealthy. Lydia had means. She was rich because you don't become a merchant of purple cloth back then without having a lot of wealth. And wealth for the early church, for Christ followers, was not a problem to solve, but a tension to manage. Wealth in every generation of the church is always a challenge, but it's not an obstacle to the good news. It's not a barrier. And it reminds us that really rich people need Jesus too. And Lydia didn't worship the many gods that her neighbors did, but she was a Gentile who worshiped God as a Jew. And that means she was called a God-fearer. It goes on, it says, as she listened to us, the Lord opened her heart and accepted what Paul was saying. See the pattern there? She genuinely wants to hear more of what Paul has to say. She wants the good news, and she opens her heart, and she steps over the line of faith. And then what happens next is incredible. Verse 15, she was baptized along with other members of her household. Now, it's remarkable that she gets baptized right away, but I want you to think of the rest of that. The entire household, that means because she's wealthy, she has a household of people who gather around her. And these people respect her and honor her so much that they want what she's just received. And they say, if this is good enough for Lydia, this is good enough for us. I want what she has. I want to be baptized too. And they all step over the line of faith. And she asked us to be her guests. The first thing Lydia does after stepping over the line of faith and having her entire household baptized is she offers gospel hospitality back to Paul and his ministry team. Then she says, if you agree that I truly believe in the Lord, come and stay at my home. And she urged us until we agreed. Now, in other words, Lydia was relentless. She was saying, have you ever seen somebody who was relentless in their hospitality? They simply will not take no. I will provide you with hospitality. Well, that's what Lydia's doing right here. And finally, they relent and they say, yes, we'll do it. And what Lydia's really crying out for here, for Paul and Silas, saying, come mentor me. Come pour into me. Let me learn more. Let me understand more of who this Jesus is and how he wants me to live. And she's also saying, because she's wealthy and she has a home that's large enough for it, she's saying, let me be the conduit for the new movement of God right here in this city of Philippi. I mean, the church is going to gather together in her home. That's gospel hospitality. And she's saying, in essence here, she's extending herself, and she's becoming the founder and the leader of Jesus' church in Philippi. And it is not a problem 2,000 years ago that she was a woman leader. I think that we don't feel the radical nature of that as much today, but that was incredibly radical back then. That's why I fully support Pastor Taylor as the leader of this church, of this community of faith, and what she does here. Yes, we're one church with three services, but I'm proud and privileged to have her as my colleague along this journey and in the spirit of Lydia. So as a founder and leader of that church, Lydia is not a circle the wagon kind of person. She is all about rolling out the red carpet with the purpose of extending the gospel. I've always had this dream. It's not a vision. This is just a dream of that I'd get to serve a church with a statue of Jesus out front with a smile on his face. I would want one with a bigger smile than that. But, I mean, I like the open arms part, open wide like that. But it's more important than literally having a statue of Jesus, open arms and smiling out in front of the church. It's more important that we live out the value of that picture that we have. Lydia modeled an open arms of Jesus kind of church. She welcomed all people well. And like Lydia, we get to welcome others, all others, because God first welcomed us. And because Jesus welcomed all people, we welcome all people as well. And gospel hospitality means that we extend ourselves and we change our attitudes and our behaviors to receive people who are different from us. Why? Because their feeling welcome is more important than us getting our own way. And so we can either be a circle the wagon church. And remember, sometimes the church must circle the wagons, but we can't always be a circle the wagon church. Mainly, we also get to be a roll out the red carpet church. And the choice is ours in how we live that out. Let's pray. Dear God, we are incredibly grateful for this community of faith, for the way that you, the value of gospel hospitality is lived out so beautifully here. And I pray your incredible blessings on this Vessel community, that you will help them grow and thrive and be challenged to reach more people for Jesus, to recognize that they have a story worth sharing and worth receiving. And help all of us, God. Help us just find new ways of offering that incredible gift of rolling out the red carpet. We love you, and we thank you in the strong name of Jesus. We all agreed and said, amen.